Jonathan Nee is a banker, a lawyer, a professor at Columbia Business School, the co-author of Curse of the Mogul, the author of The Accidental Investment Banker, and the author of Class Clowns, his newest book, in which he dives into the world of education and profit, which, to be clear, is not the same as for-profit education. The question that he asks in this book is, why is it so hard to make money investing in education? He presents case studies of failed investment, explaining the finances in ways that the right-brained among us can understand, and presenting common sense recommendations for future investors. Jonathan's joined tonight by Katherine Bradley, the founding chair of the CityBridge Education Board and the president of CityBridge Foundation, which incubates and invests in the most promising practices in public education, successfully, I should say. She serves on the board of Princeton and the Kipp Foundation and is the perfect guide for our conversation tonight. So please join me to welcome Jonathan Nee and Katherine Bradley.
Thank you. So thank you, Lily. Thank you, everyone, for being here. It is such a privilege for me to do this interview with my friend, Jonathan Nee. And I actually want Jonathan to start by just telling you, the audience, a little bit about himself. Because Jonathan's first book was called The Accidental Investment Banker. And he really has had this varied career of different parts. I think of you a bit as a 21st century Renaissance man. So start us just with the different parts of the Jonathan Nee platform, and then we'll get into the book.
So I am, if that is what it's come to be a Renaissance man, that we are in a world of hurt here as a society. I do have a few different jobs, so I am a banker still. I'm a professor at Columbia Business School, and I do a little writing. And I do get asked a lot, sort of, what's the mix? And I have never come up with an intelligible answer. And I think part of that, beyond the sacrosanct hours that I am teaching and scheduled to teach, which is a very small percentage of my life, the rest of it is surprisingly integrated. So the banking and the professoring and the writing are actually, to me, on a day-to-day basis, they sort of feel as one. Now, that wouldn't normally be the case, but I'm at a business school, so being able to bring people who I worked on a transaction with up to the business school to meet with students is a very natural thing, and you'd be surprised how desperate bankers are to find an excuse to talk to a senior executive about something other than getting them to hire you. And saying, hey, you know, you should come up to the business school sometime and talk. That's actually good for business. And the experience is something that I can write about.
And so, are you teaching a course every semester at Columbia?
I do. Okay. I'm actually a full-time professor.
All right. So full-time professor, full-time investment banker, and complete about a book every other year? Is that about the right way to think of it?
No. I complete a book every couple of times a decade.
Okay. So it has to be good, right?
Yeah. And it gets harder and harder as it turns out. You know, the first one is the thing that you've had in your head, and then the next one is the thing that you kind of had in your head and you had to think about it. But now you're treated to the third one where you're really kind of scratching the bottom of the barrel. So I don't know. I don't know when the fourth one will be.
So this book is about education, and Jonathan has been known really as a media expert. That's certainly what the second book, Curse of the Moguls, was about. So talk us through this book. What made you want to write it? What were you trying to accomplish?
So it's actually not as big a leap as you might think. So education is a media business. That is, at the business of education is a media business. So if you think of the media industry as the production and distribution of information and entertainment, education is a teeny sliver of that. So there are consumer media businesses like movies and shows. There are professional media businesses like, if there are any doctors in the house, you know Elsevier. They produce scientific journals, so that's a media business, but professional audiences. And education is a media business, actually largely sold to government entities, at least most of it. So when I wrote the last book, which was called Curse of the Mogul, which was mostly talking about how it was that the executives who lead the biggest media companies had managed to destroy a extraordinary amount of value over the last decades. During the course of that, the subject of education came up. Me, as a media banker, have done a lot of media transactions in education. I sold McGraw-Hill Education. I worked on selling e-college, an online software business in education. And while I was doing the research around media in general, the thing that struck me about people who were involved in the business of education was that although, like the other media businesses, people did overwhelmingly badly from a financial point of view, there were a couple of important differences that I thought were worth at least exploring. One was the animating force of getting involved was quite different. That is, in general, media moguls are doing it to have a very, very good time, frequently on at the expense of the shareholders, but you know, that's what they're about. In the case of education, that is not generally the case. I mean, maybe people will ask, or some reaction to my book was that I'm too nice to them, that actually, that they're not really trying to do good. But you would be surprised. Rupert Murdoch really was trying to do well by doing good, by pouring $1 billion of shareholders' money down the drain on Amplify. He really was. He wanted to transform education for the better. You think about Rupert Murdoch, he hates the idea of big, staid incumbents, and he wants to blow it up and make money doing it and make the world, in his mind anyway, better. And his view of the big textbook monopolies ripe for that kind of disruption, that is what he was doing. So one thing that was different was that the people who did this were not doing it for, you know, purely to have a good time. They were actually trying to do well by doing good, but succeeding at neither. And the second thing that was different, and why I thought it was worth a book, was that it actually kind of matters. You know, if our new Secretary of the Treasury decides to pour a few $100 million into Relativity Media, he will get a bunch of very good parties and meet a lot of very attractive people out in Hollywood, and the world will go on happily, despite the fact that he and his investors did bad in Relativity Media. However, in the case of Amplify or any of these other investments where entire school districts, in the case of K-12, have invested a huge amount of time, turned the boat of training teachers to use these platforms and these products, and then they're gone, there's a big cost to that. And in the overall ecosystem of education, when for-profit businesses are sustainable and do well, they play a really important stabilizing role in the overall ecosystem because, as we all know, the government is a little fickle. And nonprofits are businesses of a type, but they are also at the whim of frequently government and frequently, you know, people who are donors. And so having, even though it's a relatively small part of the overall ecosystem, having stable, successful, thriving businesses that produce something that works as kind of a pillar of that infrastructure is important. So I thought it was worth thinking about.
So you've touched on one of the things I wanted to start with in talking about the book, which is that you debunk a whole bunch of myths that that people believe are true. And if you haven't read the book yet, you will see that Jonathan just eviscerates a whole lot of the things that people believe to be true. I think the first one is something that certainly I have fallen prey to as well, which is, can't we improve education by using business practices within schools? And because you've kind of addressed this, let me just read this one quote of Jonathan's in the book. He says, quote, "Our greatest minds and our deepest pocketbooks seem committed to making education better. How can we reconcile this depth of commitment to improve things with the apparent inability to do so?" And I think that's one of the questions you're trying to answer throughout the whole book, is why people keep failing. I don't know if you want to take a quick stab at the why part of that now or come back to it later.
Well, I don't know how satisfactory my answer to that is. Part of what attracted me to doing this actually relates to my secret passion for public policy. So my first job out of law school and business school was actually with a number of people who were here tonight, almost 30 years ago, as a lobbyist here in Washington. I'm not an expert in public policy, and I'm not an expert in certainly in educational public policy, but just as a regular person who's interested in the topic, it has always been a source of frustration to me that every time, I live in New York now, every time the city schools, for instance, announce the results of whatever assessment has been done that year, everybody who has any point of view on any policy matter announces that those results prove their point. And it occurred to me that if I went down the road of this book, that whether a business makes money or loses money is a different question from whether or not it is pedagogically sound, whether it makes the world a better place. I mean, it's different. It's a different question. But it does have the virtue of being very clearly answerable. They made money or they lost money. And the people who lose money didn't go into it trying to lose money. They went into it trying to make money. And they went into it based on a whole series of assumptions about how people learn, how products get sold, what the structure of the industry is, how it works. And so I had this idea that if I kept a straight face and didn't act like I was a policy expert and just analyzed the systemic failures, which are unambiguous failures, and looked at what were the assumptions that were wrong that led to them, that maybe somebody smarter than me, who actually does spend their life thinking about what's good policy and what's bad policy and what's good pedagogy and bad pedagogy, might find some lessons from that that actually could be usefully applied to the public policy arena.
So let's do one of those assumptions in the book, and that is Mike Milken, with the very grandiose assumption that he could create an education company with such scale that he could build a cradle-to-grave, better than anything anyone had seen, education company. Why does that assumption that scale will work in this industry, end up failing?
So the issue is not that scale isn't a great competitive advantage. Scale absolutely is a phenomenal competitive advantage, which is at the heart of most, if not all, great franchises. The issue is understanding what scale is. So scale is a very specific technical term. It's not the same as really big. That's really big. Scale is a different concept. Scale has to do with relative size, and it has to do with two relative issues. One is relative size within the relevant domain, And Milken thought the domain was literally learning anything from being an infant to when you die. That is not a domain, right? That is, you know, something
else.
A
rainbow.
Yeah, that is something else. But the other relative concept that is hugely important in understanding around scale is the cost structure of the enterprise relatively reliant on fixed costs? Let me say that again, because it's actually hugely important. The cost structure of a business has some costs that change as you do more, and some costs that are the price of admission. To even start, you have to spend a certain amount of fixed costs. Okay. So a business that was all variable cost, that is not fixed costs. So a business where if you produce a second one, your costs go up by 2x. A pure variable cost business, if you're the biggest guy, it doesn't make a difference, right? It only makes a difference if you have a lot of fixed costs, because if there's a lot of fixed costs, you can spread those over the larger output. And then your average cost is lower and you're better off. So Milken, let's forget this sort of the grandiose idea that he was going to do everything. Let's just take the specific ideas he had. So he thought, you know what's a great industry? Because it's all fragmented and I'll just roll it up and I'll be the biggest and I'll be the best. And the area he picked was early childhood learning and daycare. You know, it's a very fragmented industry. A lot of people, bankers think of this all the time. Hey, that's a fragmented industry. Let's roll it up. Frequently, it's a fragmented industry because rolling it up doesn't do anything for you. Because if it's all a variable cost business, a big rolled up one probably is going to be less efficient because it's impossible to manage effectively. Because what are the costs of daycare? It's all local. The marketing, it's all local advertising, people overwhelmingly, it's all local.
And was that not obvious to very, very skilled business people that daycare was not going to have any fixed costs to roll up?
Apparently not. I mean, apparently not. So they literally bought a bunch of these around, you know, scattered around, or we could talk about the Chris Whittle with Edison. It's local density. So what are the fixed costs of these kinds of businesses that like K-12 schools or daycare centers? What are the fixed costs? Well, it's the people. Overwhelmingly, these businesses are 80% people. Well, in terms of managing those people, in terms of recruiting those people, obviously local, in terms of somebody sick in this school, let's get somebody from another school. Well, if your only other school is in Iowa, it's not going to work as well, right? So effectively managing the resources and the fixed costs, you know, if you put an advertisement in the Washington Post, you know, it works. It costs, they don't charge you less if you have 5 schools than if you have 100 schools.
Yeah, but that's such a small piece of the overall cost structure that it doesn't end up mattering.
It depends which business. In higher ed, it's actually a very large part of the cost structure, the marketing. But it's the people. So the point is not that scale doesn't matter. Scale absolutely matters. But if you don't understand what the industry you're talking about is and where the fixed cost base is, then you're gonna do badly.
So this book has some of the most colorful business people of our era. And did you actually interview them, Chris Whittle, Rupert Murdoch, Joel Klein, John Paulson?
Of that list, I interviewed, of that list, the people who I interviewed on the record, Joel Klein talked to me on the record. Some of them I didn't. They didn't want to talk to me. And some of them, I wasn't that interested. Because, again, my focus was really on the business and the numbers and what happened. So in some instances, I was more interested than in other interests.
Do you have a personal favorite?
In terms of as a character? Well, you know, and I didn't interview this person because I'd say in general, the people aren't rogues. The people generally did want to do good. I would say the one that I am the most suspicious of in that regard. And a good indicator is whether they use their own money. Right. That is probably the best tell. There is a character named Barry O'Callahan.
This is in the Houghton Mifflin story.
Who had a tiny little company that he was an Irish banker. You will find actually one of the recurring themes here, which is sad to say, is that most of the people who do badly here are in all of the professions that I'm in. So there's a shocking number of former bankers, former lawyers, some former consultants who are put at the head of these. And part of it really does relate to, I mean, they are very smart people, and they're very articulate people, and they're people who believe strongly in things. And have been very successful in their lives and make the mistake of thinking that those particular successes are applicable to knowing how to operate a large, complex business effectively.
So one of the lessons you bring out is that people should stop trying for the big transformational moments and just execute a series of small incremental steps well. And Jonathan, although he's writing about business, he also has been an observer of the citywide reform efforts that have been going on in New York City, in Newark. You've written about the Newark reform efforts here in Washington. So do you think that same lesson, execute well on lots of incremental steps, holds for public policy and city reform efforts too?
So the answer is, yeah, I do. But I don't have the same basis for it as I do in this, beyond as a casual
observer. But you did study Newark and wrote about Newark.
I did. And I would say there are two pieces to that. One relates to the basic point, which is focus really, really matters in anything that you do. You know, choose something and do it really, really well. And if you have ambitions well beyond it, great. After you do the one thing well, do the thing right next to it really, really well, and then eventually you will do a lot of things really, really well. But starting by trying to do them all well is overwhelmingly a recipe for disaster. But the second piece does relate to what we were talking about before, which is doing them well involves actual execution, right? And the skills involved in these particular jobs, depending on, again, what the business is, are very particular. You know, when you are a very smart and successful person and you did great at school and you checked every box, you get this idea that, you know, oh, I can do that, you know, sure. That, how hard could that be? Oh, those guys are just jerks. You know, I'll just get in there. You know, operating excellence is a bizarrely diminished skill by folks who care about the big picture. And if you really, really care about the big picture, you need to go to a shrink and learn to respect operating excellence, because you will never be able to achieve that big picture without appreciating and valuing the people who actually do that execution.
So, well said. Thank you. So since we're at the very beginning of the year, new year, I'm going to finish up with having you give us a few bright spots, and I'll ask you a few questions, because we do have to have something positive to hang on to.
Absolutely.
After a litany of business failures in this book. So first question, Common Core. is that going to give us an opportunity for scaled businesses that hasn't existed so far?
So it would in theory. It won't in practice.
Why is that?
Because, I mean, it doesn't exist anymore, essentially. I mean, how many states have not gotten rid of it?
I think I'd say they renamed it more than gotten rid of it.
Well, but they're, I asked somebody very senior at Houghton Mifflin, how many SKUs, different SKUs of a typical textbook that is around the country do you have to prepare? And the answer was something like, this is in a common core world. I'm sorry, a SKU, it's not an education term. So if you go to a supermarket and they say, well, how many SKUs, how many different versions of the same thing, how many different SKUs in the deodorant aisle, right? So how many different products, so there's a different product number on the thing that you put the barcode on. It's a different SKU. So for the same, fifth grade English textbook that is around the country, in theory, is Common Core. You might think, it's Common Core, so there's one book. The answer is like 100,000. I mean, it's like ridiculous. It's crazy. And so, again, yes, scale around agreed
but it
pedagogies,
won't be easy.
But I don't see it. Look, my daughter goes to the lycée in New York. You know, they have a Common Core in France, and it's only as old as Napoleon. Right? And so they actually know a fair amount about the pedagogy, and they've got a reasonable track record to adjust and to whatever. But it's in the American psychology that every locality believes that they're making things better by, doing this little tweak on the algebra textbook for Massapequa, but it's really, it's a problem on a number of levels. So just from a fixed cost point of view, just think about it, right? If everybody does that, it creates big problems for the business, but it also creates big problems for, kids who have.
If we have a mobile society, it's
in a mobile
really
society,
a
kids are moving around, and it's a different textbook. It's one of the great things about my daughter going to the lycée is, if somebody
she could live in Paris,
if she or in China, because there's a lycée in China, and she'll go there, and it's the same thing. It's fantastic. So my daughter can go around the world without that. Most kids can't move 30 miles and not have a problem.
So there are a few little bright spot companies in the book, and I have to say I was really slow to understand the name of one of them. I looked at it and I thought, what does this mean, Turnitin? And then I realized, no, the name of the company is Turnitin, as in turn in your paper, not Turnitin. So that's one that you actually like quite a bit. So if you could tell the audience about that company, what it does, and this is almost at the end. So if people would like to start lining up for questions, we have two different microphones, and we will go right into about 30 minutes of Q&A once we're done. So Turnitin.
Great. So Turnitin is a breathtakingly good business. So most great businesses, whether in education or otherwise, typically have scale on the one hand, and something called customer captivity on the other hand. And the thing about customer captivity is it says if somebody else spends a lot of money, borrows a lot of money, and creates the same scale and says, okay, I'm going to charge the same as that guy, I'll get half of the customers. They don't get any of the customers because there's customer captivity. And all the incumbent has to do is say, I'll match anything this other guy does, and they won't lose one client. So scale plus captivity is the key. And there are two kinds of scale. We talked about one, which is fixed cost scale. In a digital world where fixed costs go down very low, and people originally thought, oh, this is great. Fixed costs have gone down really low. I'm going to be able to make a lot more money. Well, it doesn't work that way because fixed costs was your competitive advantage. when fixed costs go down low, yes, your costs go down, but guess what comes in? Competitors, new entrants. There's another kind of scale in the digital world, though, that often works as well, and that's called network effects. So fixed costs aren't required, but in a business where, think about any kind of marketplace or Facebook, every new member of the Facebook social network makes the product a better product because there are more people on the network. Or if it's a marketplace, one more buyer, it attracts more sellers. If there are more sellers, that's more interesting to buyers. So it's what they call a flywheel effect, or it's a virtuous circle. So Turnitin is a simple concept, which is a school, either a high school or a university, requires all of the students to turn in their papers. And there's a software that checks for plagiarism. Now you say, well, okay, that sounds fine. That doesn't sound like such a great business, though, because basically you give a couple of smart programmers a six-pack. You know, they can develop a product that will check against, you know, Wikipedia or whatever, which is basically how my 12-year-old cheats. But once you get to high school and college, you get a little bit more sophisticated. So you say, well, why is that a great scale business? Well, it turns out the way kids cheat is they get a paper from a friend at another school, or they go to a site with where anonymous people share papers. That's not available to look at on Wikipedia. But if the institutions that those people are, who are giving you, feeding you their papers, if the institutions they're at also have Turnitin, and those papers have been turned in, well, there's a network effect, because if you're a school that knows that you've got a plagiarism problem, and you have a choice between picking a product that all of the other schools have against a product that maybe has a slightly better software but has none of the relevant information, you're obviously going to pick the one. Mm-hmm. And so this is a breathtakingly powerful scale.
Started by a few Berkeley grad students, was it? Or
yeah,
students?
It was,
and what do you think it's worth now?
Well, I sold it, so I sold it for,
so you know,
I sold it for about $800 million 2 years ago.
Wow.
And I'm sure it's worth a lot more now.
All right, so last question, then we're going to go to the audience. I had forgotten until reading this book that when Chris Whittle's Avenue School, which is the very elite private school which is now opened in New York, when it was announced, there was, with great fanfare, I think a piece of property either bought or contracted for in Bethesda, that DC was going to have its own Avenues campus. So is that over forever, or are we ever going to see Avenues here?
So the short answer is I have no actual idea. They got, as always happens with Chris Whittle, he eventually gets pushed out, so he's not there anymore. The new owners were smart enough to push him out, so they're unlikely to do anything as crazy and ambitious as he had said. But at the end of the day, the reason I don't know the answer is it's a local market. It's a local business. And Avenues might break even in New York because of the very peculiar qualities of the New York, the supply-demand curve in New York. I don't know enough about Washington, D.C. as to whether that particular proposition would work. But my guess is it wouldn't particularly work as an Avenue school. It may be, somebody may buy that property and build a school.
Okay. Thank you, Jonathan. And we're going to go to the audience. And if you can make sure that all the audience questions are right into the mic, we are filming and recording. And please introduce yourself before the
Hello.
Question.
Thank you. Ed Bartholomew, I enjoyed your talk. I wonder if you could comment on the online platforms like edX or Coursera, Khan Academy, and whether you see any potential for those to either on a standalone basis raise the bar or perhaps integrate it into some sort of hybrid delivery mechanism?
Great question. So the list of entities that you mentioned are a mix of for-profit ones and not-for-profit ones. So Khan Academy, I'm pretty sure, is not-for-profit. edX is certainly not-for-profit. It competes against two for-profit MOOCs, Coursera and what's the other one?
Udacity.
So what I would say about the for-profit ones, particularly these MOOCs that are now valued, not because of anything other than, you know, some venture capitalist put money in it or some German company who didn't know any better put some money in it. They're both unicorns. They're both valued at over $1 billion, both Udacity and Coursera. I think that's pretty crazy. And I don't think that they will ever work as currently conceived. And one of the other themes that we didn't have a chance to talk about that I think is one of the themes that actually does overarch both the for-profit mistakes and the public and not-for-profit mistakes is falling in love with an idea to such an extent that you ignore the reality of what's working and what's not working. And the whole concept of a MOOC, the ideology is in the name. One of the O's is open, okay? So there's a whole history of this idea, the open, there's like a name for it. There's this ideology that underlies this concept of a MOOC. And open means free. So they go to this and they say, okay, here's do whatever you want. Oh yeah, but by the way, it's got to be free. Now, it turns out that doesn't work. And if what you actually care about is not the O, but creating a better world, you should be a little flexible about the O. But a lot of people are not flexible about the ideology, and as a result, it ends badly. And so I think that those, unless there's a radical shift in the business model, I think those are going to end badly. And they are trying to shift it, but they're trying to shift it in these kind of they're shifting it like in the ways that people in Washington try to raise taxes without calling it a tax. I mean, and it's so convoluted rather than just say. And one of the great ironies here is, so every university needs to have a MOOC, right? And so they're all losing, these universities which are nonprofits, and they're all facing huge financial pressures, are all doing MOOCs, and it's costing them money. And here's two facts that are pretty horrifying. So it's costing them money. So what does that mean? That means kids who need money, like to pay tuition, are getting less of it because they're doing MOOCs. And guess what? Guess who uses the MOOCs? Overwhelmingly, student populations who already have graduate degrees, whose average income is way higher than the kids who are not getting financial aid because they're subsidizing MOOCs because somebody said open is really cool. It's a little screwy.
Everything's a resource trade-off. Okay, sir.
Hi. It's a very simple question, I think, and you probably answered it in part at least, but not clearly enough for me at least. What does, to you, what does it mean that a bunch of folks with very demonstrated business acumen haven't been able to make money in the education field privately? What does that say about the sort of efficiency, economic efficiency of government, public education?
So I don't know that it says anything about that in particular. I do think that it says that if you fall in love with an idea, that there's danger ahead. And that these are folks that if they can figure out a way to put a little bit of space between their love of the idea, and they do have skills that should allow them to succeed. And indeed, there are. I do have a chapter of not just Turnitin with a bunch of very successful businesses where people aren't trying to revolutionize the world. Some of them do have revolutionary ambitions, but they start small. So I do think the why, I think, relates to the psychology of falling in love with the idea and also the practicality of not being able to do multiple things at one time effectively, rather than it's impossible and right. and the like. It doesn't mean the fact that people misapply business concepts doesn't mean business concepts are bad. It means you shouldn't right. misapply them.
It seems like a field in which fixed costs are a relatively low fraction of total costs could favor business for wrapping things up, like you say, but could also favor government just because they can get better prices on common things and so forth. So it wasn't clear to me that there was a clear answer to which way things would go.
But, and there are a lot. Look, there. I'm talking about education, all kinds of education, everything from childhood learning centers to a right. plagiarism software. And so the cost structure of there are lots of different right, cost yeah. structures. So it's true. That's true about some of them, but not all of them.
All right, thank you,
sir.
Jim Farmer, I'm an M. Two quick questions. When the University of Phoenix went public in 1994, the university began to focus on growth. And John Sperling seemed to lose his passion. Is this a result of the incentives of a large public enterprise?
So I think for the for-profit higher ed, so University of Phoenix was one of the earliest for-profit education businesses. Government regulation created some very, very perverse incentives in that industry, which certainly encouraged a lack of focus. I think government regulation encouraged some both bad behavior, but also, frankly, bad business decisions. You know, when regulation is frequently a source of competitive advantage, right? There are a lot, I do, in the media industry, right? Cable. Broadcasting spectrum. It's all government-created domains that create the advantage. The key, though, is to remember, always remember, what the government giveth, the government take away. So when you have a barrier to entry created by the government or some largesse created by the government, the trick is to remember it might not always be there. So use that time to build something that will be sustainable. And in the case of higher education, that will typically mean that you need to pick either, again, regional density, because that's where the fixed costs are, or pick domains, particular disciplines where you can get relative scale within that discipline. Because of the incentive to basically just get anybody to take out a loan, people were like, let's just build schools any old place, let's do any program, any whatever. And then when it all came crashing down, and we can talk about the ways that happened and whether that made sense or it didn't make sense, there was nothing left. So many of them really didn't have anything left. There are some, however, that did a better job than others, so that when it came down, that they will survive. So that's how I would think about it. But yes, I do think they lost their focus, both from a regional focus. If you look, actually, in the book, in the chapter, we show kind of during from that period when they started all going public and going crazy. Originally, they were all, each of them had a regional footprint that was highly dense. And then within a few years, they were just scattered all over the place. They used to have each of them focused on two or three disciplines, and knew them and did them and delivered them very well to being in everything.
Second question was, in The Curse of the Mogul, you have a classification of education and training media and services. Does that business, as you were describing it in that book, differ from higher education?
So higher education would be a subset of that.
Okay. Thank you.
Over here.
Yes. I'm Patricia Clark, and you started out the talk mentioning that these people were people that had made a lot of money but were interested in doing good. And I guess I would sort of posit that very close alongside that doing good, it occurs to me that given the names you mentioned, there was also an element of rehabilitating or burnishing reputation, Rupert Murdoch, Michael Milken, and Zuckerberg. And it's interesting that the media actually never writes as much about the failures. It's nice to hear a book about failures because they don't write as much about the failures as the launches. But one reason then for these problems in doing good might be that there's a real divergence between doing good in the social sense, I mean, if we're talking welfare economics point of view, and making a lot of money. And your Elsevier example, I think, is an excellent one. I mean, in terms of blocking access to knowledge, that's a real problem, the huge profitability of Elsevier. So where do you think these two align well, and how could they be made to align better?
I just think, I would say, I don't know, the fact that somebody wants to redeem themselves, whatever it takes. I mean, the reality is that Milken, you know, in the area of cancer, Milken has actually, one might argue, he was revolutionary in the field of finance. I mean, whatever you say about him, the creation of high-yield financing has been the source of a lot of economic activity in the world. And when he put his mind to cancer, I'm not an expert, that some people say that he's had almost as revolutionary an impact there.
The Milken Scholars Program is another example that he's done.
So I think structurally, trying to do both at the same time, it's just you're each one by themselves is super hard. And putting any constraint on yourself in terms of optimizing one or the other by trying to solve both equations simultaneously, I just think it is just a recipe for disaster. I mean, look at Zuckerberg was not a for-profit, right? So here's a guy who is hugely smart, and one of the smartest things he ever did was he married way above his station. His wife is way smarter, and she's very interested in this area. And he went all in Newark, and he was not trying to be for-profit. He was just trying to make the disaster of that place better, and just failed miserably. And he wasn't trying to do that and, in addition, try to make money at the same time. So honestly, I think what a person should do is either do the best for-profit you can do, do the best not-for-profit you can do, or realize that the biggest contribution you can make to education, if you're in the for-profit realm, is to develop a sustainable business and focus on that, period. Because if it ain't sustainable, it ain't gonna make a difference to anybody, and it could do some real damage.
Sir.
My name is Walter Rosenkrantz. I'm a retired professor of mathematics, and I spent a sabbatical year in Paris in 85, 86.
I'm very jealous.
And my children were then ages 10 and 14, and they went to the École Active Bilingue. It was at that time that I became interested in math education, because I thought the French system was very, very good. In fifth grade, they used calcul mental, mental arithmetic, which prepares the kids for abstract algebra. And in any event, I looked in your index, and I didn't find mathematics in it. So this upset me. Given that 50, with the Common Core or the SATs or the ACTs, math is 50% of the your performance, and the English language arts is the other 50%. How can you possibly succeed in reforming education without hiring a mathematician?
Well, my father is a math professor, and so I'm highly sympathetic to your observations. And math doesn't appear as a character in the book, but many of the products, because in in K-12 curriculum, reading and mathematics are together represent a huge percentage of the spending. So it is indirectly covered, but it isn't covered as there's no. I don't think I cover any math-focused math product, but there are some. There are a number of very interesting just math products and people who have been successful at building sort of niche businesses that are just around mathematics.
Can I?
You don't frame it like this, but the book covers a product or a school product called School of One, which is just math. It is 100% math. We just don't. In the book, call it out as such.
Although that one is a little questionable.
I mean, there's a general phenomenon here that I don't understand. When you have a fever, you go to a doctor. When you have a toothache, you go to a dentist. And you have math education, you go to a politician. Where's the sense in that?
Well, as you're learning, the alternative is to go to a banker or a lawyer, which is, you don't.
I mean, it's ridiculous. I actually looked at the Common Core, and it's filled with sensible suggestions. For example, in the eighth grade, students should know how to prove the Pythagorean theorem. In the seventh grade, students should understand repeating decimals and so on. If you try to compute 1/9 on your computer, you'll get 0.1111. That goes on indefinitely. What kind of a number is that? When you try to solve that question at the seventh grade.
Yeah, just right to the microphone.
Let me just finish. Yeah.
Just stay at the microphone because we can't hear you.
Yeah. When you try to explain why 1/9 becomes 0.111, an infinitely repeating decimal, what does that number mean? That leads you to the notion of limit,
which is a fundamental notion of calculus. I'm highly sympathetic to your observation.
I would say that the math curriculum will be reformed one lesson plan at a time, not these grandiose plans to make money or all the language that you use of investment bankers. That's not going to work.
Thank you.
Sir.
Hi. I listen to moaning and groaning about education all the time, and I was just wondering if maybe some of this money, instead of throwing it at young people, we should be throwing it at older folks for mentorship and business development that would vocationalize education somewhat. Because we know if we give young people money, it tends to get thrown away. So why not give it to responsible older people and let them take some interest, like everybody like to make some extra money, to mentor people. So it's just part of the funds, you know.
And let me just say that after Jonathan's answered this question, we have time for one more. So if anybody would like to take a position at one of the mics.
So as the father of a 12-year-old, I completely agree that the money just goes in and you don't see anything for it. It's awful. But the book does cover a number of businesses that serve vocational markets. And indeed, a lot of the businesses that focus on higher education have really been built around trying to expand the market for continuing education. So I would say, you know, what used to be called non-traditional students are really the target audience for many of the for-profit businesses, because digital education has allowed a level of flexibility to folks who have very difficult lives and couldn't possibly, you know, drag themselves into classes and what have you, that are in fact businesses that serve exactly that target market.
So part of what I meant was not necessarily
to the Mike.
Part of what I meant was not necessarily money for older folks' education, but for older folks to teach younger folks. In other words, we've got all these people who know so much, and these kids aren't getting advantage of it. So maybe we're throwing a lot of money away in a different.
Great.
And I had two takers from my last question, so we'll take both of you. So, sir, you first.
As a retired high school teacher, sitting and listening to this discussion about business kind of goes over my head a lot, except that I think about all the discussions I've had or listened to in this very room about the failures of democracy building in Iraq and Afghanistan and how difficult it ultimately is to get down to the individual family, the individual people. And I can say to everybody here, when you get down to a 15-year-old and you're trying to work with this person either on math or reading or a habit of mind, that's what is very difficult. And as I read about all of the failures in Newark, I just kept thinking about the 15-year-olds in my classroom, who everything I tried over the years, and it was a lot of years, and man, it was really tough to get them to learn anything. And I feel like that still ends up being the kernel of difficulty. And I wondered if that's something that you encountered yourself.
Look, I would just make the observation that magic bullet ideas, whether they're business ideas or public policy ideas, when it comes to delivering education, are uniformly disastrous. Because at the end of the day, if it's a business plan that's serving those markets that claims that it can succeed without actual good teachers and effective leaders of the institutions in which those teachers operate, it's clearly a fraud. Because at the end of the day, that is central. And indeed, in any scale does not replace that, right? At the end of the day, having that is what effective execution looks like in K to 12 education.
And the final question.
I'm Samira Daniels. I've been interested in education myself from my Boston days. You mentioned that this idea, the big idea, and it's is problematic, and I've been listening to the conservatives and the liberal factions on this whole the debate about education. Do you think that the problem is the fact that somebody comes in and says, this is the sort of overarching paradigm that we should follow. Is that what you meant by the big idea, that they come in with one religion as a parallel to religion, and this is going to make us more, enlightened citizens? I mean, is it at that
yes,
level?
It is, but. So it's an ideological commitment that is not combined with a commitment to understanding what execution, both respecting execution and undertaking execution to achieve whatever the animating objective is. And it also is typically not associated with a willingness in the face of contrary facts to potentially shift the ideology a little bit to achieve what the underlying objective is.
And just quickly, now people are beginning to incorporate, cognition and, how do you think that those, the expansion of those areas, how do you think that will influence?
The answer is I don't know, but I hope it does. And my father is a math professor, and my wife is a cognitive neuroscientist. And the thing that drives her the craziest is, in fact, that many of these ideologies have nothing to do with what the science is about how people actually learned. The next time you hear somebody say, as if it is intuitively obvious, that really the objective that all of us should have in learning is personalized learning. It should be, that's the obviously, what could be wrong with that? Do you want general learning or do you want personalized learning? Right? So it may be that in certain contexts and for certain things, that's valuable. And it may be that it's a huge waste of time in a bunch of others. But it's one of these things that people say, of course, we need software that every second the teacher can know exactly who got what question right and wrong, even if there's nothing they can do about it, and it's not knowing at the end of the week how they do on the test gets you as much as that, and in fact doesn't have them distracted for the rest of the time, and much less, you know, the 3 weeks in the summer you got to train them on the software. But it doesn't matter because it's all about personalized learning. So yes, that's the point. The point is it should be tied to an actual objective you're trying to achieve, and then it should be related to actual facts as to whether the particular thing you're trying to do is related
contextual
to that objective.
Contextual intelligence, right?
Yeah.
And on that note, please join me in thanking author Jonathan Nee.